Welcome back, guys. So in the previous video, we have started building our language and implemented the basic mathematical expressions in the view of the additive expression, multiplicative, and the primary. And we've been also talking about parse trees, right? This is how it looks like, for example, for the expression 7 plus 3 times 4. Right, as you can see here, plus and times operator are also on the leaves of these trees. But we also have seen the notation of the tree, which looks something like this, right? When the operators such as plus or times or equals are actual the interior nodes, right? Or the root nodes. So in today's lecture, we'll talk more about concrete syntax trees known as CSTs and abstract syntax trees known as ASTs. And so the first thing we should say that an abstract syntax tree is just a condensed version of the parse tree or concrete syntax tree, right? And going further, interpreters or virtual machines or static analyzers work exactly and mainly with abstract syntax trees. But sometimes there might be some mixed version of the tree when abstract syntax tree can keep some extra state captured from the concrete syntax tree. So once again, in this class, I'm building a tree which we can pass later to the interpreter. We'll be looking for something which looks like on this on the right-hand side. That is abstract syntax tree. And if we look again at those trees, we see that in CST, that is in concrete syntax tree, interior nodes represent the actual productions, right, from our grammar. They match one-to-one to the productions. We see here E plus T, T times F, and the E itself. While the leaves represent the terminals, right, the actual final string values which we see in the string. That is 7, plus, 3, times, and 4. All are the terminals. While the abstract syntax trees, the interior nodes in these trees represent the operators. That is something high level already representing the language level constructs, right? And so the leaves here represent the operands of those operators. And so when we think how we can encode an AST, the simplest structure which we'll be using is just a JSON structure. And as you can see, every node in the AST will have the type. For example, the plus operator represents the binary expression, right? Here we see the type of the binary expression, which has left-hand side and right-hand side. And the right-hand side here is also a binary expression, but already of different operator, that is of the times, which also just has left and right-hand sides. Okay, so with this being said, I'm going to switch to our implementation and we'll be adding support for the ASTs today. And so before adding support for the AST, let's actually solve the assignment which we had in the previous video about the grouping operator, which looks as follows, right? If we put 2 plus 2 into parentheses, into grouping parentheses, the semantics of this evaluation completely changes, right? In this case, it should be 8 instead of 6. And as we said, the parentheses are not yet supported, so let's go ahead and implement them. But first of all, if you look at this expression, we see that the grouping operator has the higher precedence than the times operator, right? That is, it should be something as the primary expression. So this is exactly where we put it, right? Inside the primary expression. And our primary expression can be either now just a number or a grouping. So we put the open parenthesis and the closing parenthesis. So what should go inside of this grouping? Well, as we said, it might be any expression, right? It might be simple number, or 2 plus 2, or 2 times 2. That is, it should be the very basic expression, that is the additive expression itself, which further can be down destructured into either multiplicative or the primary, going to the number. And so this is pretty much it. Let's test it. Okay, execute again, and yes, now it's accepted. So take a look at this parsed value. It says currently undefined. What does it mean? Well, this is exactly the intermediate representation the parser tried to obtain when parsing this expression. And in our case, this will be exactly the AST, right? Which we don't have yet and will be adding support here. So by the end of this today's lecture, we should see in the parsed value the actual abstract syntax tree. First of all, I'm going to move the additive expression into parent node, which is called expression, since we're going to have some other type of expressions. And the additive will be just one of them. And with this, I can put the expression inside the grouping parentheses, which now clearly tells that inside the grouping might be any expression. And so let's move our number to something which is called literal. And we're also going to have multiple types of literals. For now, we support only numeric literal, right, which represent the number. But later in the course, we will add the string literal and maybe something else. And also let's abstract the grouping parentheses inside its own name and call it parenthesized expression. Okay, and now the primary expression is nice and clear. It's either the literal or it's parenthesized expression. Right, let's check whether it still works. Yes, it still works, and we still don't have the parse value. So let's go ahead and talk about ASTs. Actually, let's extend our mathematical expression and add support for the minus operator and the division operator. And before talking about ASTs, we should mention something which is called semantic action. Now, semantic action is the handler, is the callback, which is executed when parser meets some token or some production rule. And in this BNF syntax, the semantic action is put inside the curly braces, which follows the production rule. So let's start from the very basic token here with a number and do something with it inside its semantic action. Now, the return value of the semantic action is represented as double dollar sign, and we can transform somehow the value captured by the parser. And the actual value captured by the parser is held by the variables, each one for the symbol inside the production. In this case, we have only one symbol in this production, the numeric literal. That is, it's just $1, right? If we have more, it will be $2, $3, etc. So what can we do with this numeric literal? Well, parsing process works with strings. That is, when we parse the number 2, we actually didn't parse the number 2, we parsed the string 2. So inside the semantic action, we can choose to convert that string into an actual JavaScript number. And for this, we can use the number conversion. So we just directly pass the captured variable, again, it's $1, to the number function and assign it to the return value, that is to the double dollar sign. Now, in case of production has only one symbol, that is, for example, this literal and numeric literal, and in case we don't need to transform the parsed value in any way, we can just directly propagate and omit the semantic action altogether, right? It will be just propagated as is down the parse trees. But in case when production has more symbols, like for example in this parenthesized expression we have open parenthesis, then expression and closing parenthesis, we need to handle what specifically we're going to return. Now, as we said, the AST in contrast with CST is the condensed form of the tree, right? And it misses some of the details, such as grouping parentheses, right? They're not presented in the AST in any way. So for the grouping expression, that is parenthesis, what we're interested here is that the actual expression itself, and for AST, we can omit the parenthesis altogether. So the return value here should be $2, that is the expression. Now, which else productions we have with more than one symbol? This is actually the additive expression and the multiplicative expression. So let's handle those. And here's the interesting thing. Inside the semantic action, the return value should not be specifically the AST or any type of tree. It might be anything, right? Of course, for further processing of the parse language, it should be hopefully the AST. But let's show that inside the semantic action, we can actually build the full programming language right away without introducing any ASTs. For example, we may choose to implement the interpreter directly in here at the parsing stage, right? And the return value of the addition might be $1, that is the additive expression, plus $3, that is the multiplicative expression, which can be extended further. And this will perfectly work because we converted the number into actual number, and pretty much the same with the times and the division operators. So let's go ahead and test it. And as you can see, it perfectly works. Right, the semantic actions, that is the hooks, were able to correctly obtain the parsed value. Let's prove it and put the group in parentheses, which as we said, should change the semantics. And voila, we got 8 here. So this is the first crucial part today. Inside the semantic action, you can choose to return anything you want. And if you built a small, easy DSL instead of full programming language, you probably might not even need the AST and can directly return something. But as we said, we focus today on AST, so let's build an actual AST node for each production. And again, let's start from the number. And as we said, the type of the number node should be the numeric expression, okay? And the value again should be just the actual parsed number. And now let's build the nodes for the additive and multiplicative expressions. But actually, let's slightly optimize these two rules. As you can see, plus and minus will generate pretty much exactly the same nodes. So we can move these raw tokens, plus and minus, into a group of token. Let's call it additive expression. And let's just add a simple regular expression inside the tokenizer and return the additive operator token type. And as we said, the additive expression, that is the plus, is the binary expression, right? So we put type as the binary expression. We need to keep the actual operator, right? Whether it's plus or minus. So let's put the op property in this AST node. And where we take the value for the actual operator? Well, it's from the concrete syntax tree, that is the variable number 2, which will hold either plus or minus here. Now, the left-hand side of the binary expression is the $1, that is the additive expression, and the right-hand side of this binary expression is the $3, that is multiplicative expression. And this is pretty much it. This is the AST node for the additive expression. And it's pretty much the same for the multiplicative expression. Let's make it generic and get rid of the slash operator. We copy-paste the same binary expression here. Pretty much the same, we get the operator and left and right operands. And we also add the rule for the times and slash to the lexer, that is tokenizer, and call this token as multiplicative operator. Okay, let's go ahead and test it. Let's start from the simple number, which, as we said, should return an AST node containing the node type and the actual parsed value. And so there we go. We got the type numeric literal with the value 2. So congratulations, we now have the ASTs, which we can further pass to the interpreter and obtain the actual result of this program. Or we can choose to further compile this AST to the other representations, to the native code, to LLVM, etc. Let's try something else. Let's put 2 plus 2, and there we go. It just works. We got the binary expression. As you can see, the operator, that is the op, is correctly captured as plus. And we have left-hand side and right-hand side, both of which are the AST nodes for the numeric literal 2 and 2. And really, you can see here, the times operator has the higher precedence than the plus operator. And now our even more interesting part, let's put the group in parentheses, and let's see that they actually change the precedence, that is the semantics. To reiterate, this is exactly the AST. Inside this parsed value, we don't see the group in parentheses anywhere, but we see the correct semantics, which those group in parentheses enforced. Right? Again, this is exactly the difference between CST and AST. Okay, sounds great. Now we already have the ASTs, and from this point, we can continue extending this language by adding any complex expression, which we'll be doing in the next lectures. Okay, please take a look at this grammar again. Make sure you understand every piece of detail here, how we obtain the AST nodes, what each node mean, and how we, again, enforce the correct precedence. Now, in the next lecture, we will come back to the parsing theory and start talking about different parsing algorithms. We will start covering the LL parsing and gradually move into LR parsing. After the theory, we will come back to the practice and we'll implement the manual parser, actually, to see how the tokenizer is implemented, the actual manual recursive descent with backtracking and without backtracking is implemented, just to fully understand this process from the manual perspective and to appreciate how the parser generator helps us here. Okay, that's it for today. Thanks and see you in the class.